It's all good for me, bro.
Okay.
All right. So let's start an episode.
Let's kick it off. 18.
What are we doing here? Okay, theme song coming up. Yes, you are at Ear and Loathing. I know you've been waiting all week. And here we are with episode 18. We can vote.
Yeah! Woo!
Legal in some states.
Just in time for our votes not to count anymore. Yay!
Did they ever really count? Come on.
So we are the Gitmo Bros. We continue to be the number one rockers forever. No matter what episode number it is, we're always number one rockers forever. You know
and
that.
And continue to be the Gitmo Bros. And we continue to do that as well.
Yes. Yeah. Gitmo Bros.
Gitmo Bros.
And I guess as we're sitting here contemplating this episode, we come to the conclusion that George is in the torture chamber.
Oh, I am.
The George-ter chamber.
It seems like I just was. still, that last episode is still fresh in my mind.
It was smarting.
It is smarting. It still smarts.
If we get a couple more dudes on the show, we can, you know, delay the torture chamber for ourselves.
It's a good reason to do it. It's like a pyramid scheme.
Yeah. That's what we need is a couple more dudes.
You give me $60. And then 2 weeks from now, I'll give you.
Yeah. Just a couple two tree guys.
Were any of you involved in cocaine pyramids in the 80s? A few friends of mine were. Give me all your cocaine. And then.
I was involved in a beer rhombus. Don't ask me what that means.
Good night, everybody.
Good night.
I was involved in a Tylenol tussle.
So anyway, episode 18, you're at Ear and Loathing. And I guess, George, if you're ready to prepare something for us, or if you've prepared something for us, we can now check in. Well, let's get the stamp of approval from our hillbilly buddy.
Yes.
What do you say?
Yes.
Hi there. Welcome to Kibbutz Corner.
So Clem needs to know what your topic is today.
Well, you know, speaking of comedy and of Clem,
yeah.
I have a simple question. What the fuck happened to comedy? Where did it go? Where are comedy movies? Where's a big release, a big summer comedy? Where's comedy now? Where do you guys watch stuff and what do you enjoy? Because I can't find anything, and it seems to me that it's even, and I've read, and I had to Google, I feel like an idiot, I'm like, I had to Google, what's happened to comedy? Where's comedy in 2022? What's coming out?
Yeah.
And there's articles about the conclusions of why we are where we are with comedy. And I thought, as the Gitmo Bros, I think we do a good job of being funny and handling, you know, controversial subjects well, because part of this is woke culture and not being afraid to do stuff. And I think what we've handled, unwanted pregnancy.
Yeah.
We've handled racism.
Black Lives Matter.
John Bon Jovi. All three huge. Yeah.
There's fucking nothing funny about him. It's a good question. I wonder if it's easier to do and get away with, I wonder if it has anything to do with people are doing podcasts more, including many comedians have their own podcast stuff and are maybe getting their rocks off that way. And it's less like, I don't know, maybe the reins are less severe or they perceive them to be. And so they don't have to do it. I bet you that like studios are like, dude, we're going to get hollered at. We, you know, we try some fucking shit. We're going to get fucking hollered at and fuck it. Or it goes to streaming, maybe.
Yeah, you know what? It does, but then you don't like that. That was part of my research in this. So last night I tried to watch the new comedy, the new Kevin Hart comedy,
which is called
The Man from Toronto.
Okay.
Which I'd heard things might be good and Woody Harrelson's in it. I tried to watch it twice, fell asleep both times. I woke up, went back to where I was, and this was early. This was like 9 o'clock. you know, I know this happens when you get older, but I couldn't, it's just not funny. Then I went and read the reviews and, you know, it was supposed to be a studio release, like into a theater. And then they went,
right.
And it's just not funny. Well, and then the other thing is, I thought, well, you know, Judd Apatow's the guy that's always active in any kind of studio comedy for years. Even if he's not involved, they're like, let's get him anyway, just to make sure this goes well.
Yeah.
And he has a movie, which did you guys call The Bubble, that came out in April. I didn't even know it was out.
Yeah, it was rough.
Yeah, and it was rough. So, yeah, the reviews were bad. I didn't know it was even out, Aaron, so you saw it?
Well, it's streaming. I wouldn't go to a fucking, like, I can't imagine going to a theater to see a comedy these days. And I saw that, and it was fucking bad, dude. Bad.
Yeah, that's, yeah. Okay.
Bad.
And I just don't, so I don't understand where it went, where, and I even thought, and of course, Top Gun made me think of this, that there's an audience out there for comedies, for the kind of comedies we used to see. Mm-hmm. Right. We're out here. And does it eventually become, and someone brought this up on an article on the internet, someone said, does it eventually become like classic rock music? Where, you know, will studios open up a classic comedy division where you just make movies that you might be offended by these, but this generation of people won't. So we're going to put these out and will that eventually happen? Because the thing about comedies is it's always good with the margin for profit because they don't cost a lot.
Right.
That's the thing that blew me away about Man from Toronto. It's an action comedy. It was not inexpensive. There's a lot of, you know, falling out of a plane and stunts and driving and all sort of shit in it. And I'm like,
I wonder if they don't have the courage of their comedy convictions. They're like, yeah, but it's more than that. Because if they try to pitch it maybe to people, they're like, yeah, we don't, there's no space for that right now.
Yeah.
So you make it an action thing and then we can sort of, you know, catch somebody else, you know, not if somebody's offended by whatever, or I don't know. No, it's interesting. It's
right.
True.
Well, like where you're saying like a movie like the movies with The Rock in them, like Jungle Cruise, or those kind of whatever the other one he's in with the Jumanji.
Yeah.
Where that's considered a comedy. And I don't mean that. I don't mean a family. I mean the thing with Will Ferrell and Adam Sandler and all the guys that were comedians. And that's one thing that did occur to me about this that I was blown away by, but is true. So Saturday Night Live for our entire lives has been, that is the pipeline for comedy stars in this country and has been for, okay, so... Pete Davidson recently left the show to go be a star now. And he's in movies, he's in commercials, he's in everything. And it occurred to me, he's the first person ever from Saturday Night Live that he's leaving to go be a star. And he wasn't a star on Saturday Night Live. He's not a star because of Saturday Night Live.
Yeah.
He wasn't that good. He doesn't do characters. He wasn't really on the show that much. And then he started fucking some girls and apparently has a big dong. And so now he's a star. Yeah. And I thought that's unprecedented. And that's maybe where comedy's going, if you will, because like what Aaron said, I realized that because of podcasts, because of like, where do I get my laughs? And it's maybe on TikTok where I see a minute long video and I get a little giggle out of it. And then I move on, of course. But as far as a movie in a theater or even watching one on streaming and liking it, it just is comedy dead or where is it? Well, so what's your answer, Damon?
I don't know that we're entitled to be constantly guffawing like 24 hours a day.
Yeah.
I don't remember it ever being like that.
Yeah.
But when you did see a comedy that was funny, it was funny. Like here's a note, you know, I'm going to act like a studio and give Kevin Hart some notes.
Okay.
Kevin, start with funny things. say jokes and have funny situations. Like, I think you and I were talking about this, George, a couple weeks ago. We were saying, like, this... I've tried to watch Kevin... Because, by the way, I think he's a likable guy. And I like a couple of things I saw him do on SNL. But then I... So I said, okay, I like this guy. Let me check out his stand-up. I couldn't make it past, like, 5 minutes.
Yeah.
Because his version of a joke is walking out on stage and going, I have a kid. He's 6. And boy, is he a kid. That and people scream laughing at that, right. And I don't get.
You can't beat his energy these days, and so the energy apologizes for the laughs. I think, and people are just down for the ride. You know, you're like, yeah,
that's
energy.
Not
they love it, and I don't get it. I don't get it. But like, that's the move: is that the energy can win out sometimes with some dudes.
Well, yeah.
It's not funny, though.
I was interested in trying to watch Man from Toronto because you and I discussed this a few weeks ago about Kevin Hart specifically. And what we were interested in is that, so even his movie didn't make it in the theaters because they won't let a lot of people make comedies now, studio comedies. I mean, this Man from Toronto is from Sony. It's a studio comedy. Big budget, Woody Harrelson, whatever, effects. And even they saw that and went, well, this isn't going to theaters. So, because I can't think of other than possibly Seth Rogen, someone they'll give money to and say, okay, you can make a comedy.
Yeah.
I can't think of anybody else. Who loses
money, though, if they stream it? They don't have to pay for theaters. I mean, if they've taken the temperature of America's temperature.
Yeah.
It's 98.6. And
you know the way they're taking it, too.
You know, and they don't. why risk renting the theaters? Why risk especially in these days where you can say, we got so many views, we set record views. People are interested in this as long as they don't have to leave their house.
Right. I certainly think.
And it doesn't expose them in any kind of a real way. So you can have a victory that maybe isn't actually truly a victory. Because I guess presumably Netflix pays you.
They give you $25 million or whatever, right, and all done and you're finished and bird in the hand. Yeah. I think that's part of it, too.
The elephant in the room, or as Brad Paisley says, what did he say? The elephant in the South, or what was his stupid line?
Oh, would like get right the because he's an apologetic white man and he still has his Leonard Skinner shirt.
Yeah, yeah. But he had a line about the elephant in the room, but he changed it. So it said like the elephant in the South or something. Fucking God.
I was with somebody the other day who said something. They were talking about that, not the song, but they were talking about an elephant being in the room. But they said, look, the white elephant in the room is, you're not the doing
white
that
elephant.
Right.
And the white elephant. Turns out your friend was an accidental racist.
Exactly.
So you're not doing that right, which you're starting there. You're starting wrong.
The big fat gorilla in the room is that it's too dangerous for your career to go out and say things that you think are funny and everyone wants to fucking cancel you.
Or write a movie.
They're waiting with our stand-up special.
Yeah.
Like, they're sitting there waiting with their knife and fork to fucking cut you up.
Right.
And if you can just, you know, have this safe little career where you're still making around the same amount of money anyway, and you don't take any risks like that. And I'm sure they have entire teams of PR people and agents and managers, and the studio reps are all advising you on, you can't say that.
Yeah. So why would you go to colleges and get hollered at and do shows the way stand-ups used to do when you just don't have to? Just don't go.
Yeah, and I'm not saying anything original here. I mean, comedians have been complaining about this for years.
Oh, a long time, yeah.
So it's like that, to me, that's just like, how can that not affect the quantity and quality of comedy that's coming out?
That's one of the reasons given that, yeah.
Yeah.
That's,
And so that's why, like, it's so refreshing to watch Dave Chappelle. I don't know if you guys saw the new Ricky Gervais stand-up.
Yeah,
so fucking good.
Yeah.
And I told Zadra, I'm like, because I'll watch it again. It was that good. And I go, you got to watch this because it's, you don't hear anything like this anymore. He's saying shit that's so dark.
Right.
And by the way, it's not that dark. It's just now considered dark because everything has gotten so safe.
It helps because he's English, though, doesn't
he? Yeah, he sells
it. He's not from here.
Right? Yeah.
Right. So, different.
So, when those guys, and Jeselnik is another funny one. Yeah. I like his stuff, too.
Yeah.
And so those are the only guys, like, that can sort of, Ricky Gervais is kind of like, I'm fucking rich. I don't care.
Right.
You can't cancel me.
Right, yeah, I don't care.
And Chappelle's probably the same way.
Yeah,
like, they've tried to cancel me 100 times, and it never worked. Yeah. Other than that, though, like, if you don't have that standing and that power and that money, that stature, then you just have to take the safe road, you know.
Yeah. Will comedy become rock music?
Don't they stop comedy?
Don't they stop comedy? Good question.
But then there's also, speaking of podcasts, like, I don't know. I think we're funny, the three of us. Yeah. I don't know that other people think we're funny, but I kind of don't care.
Right.
But guys,
we don't have a lot of money, but though, so
we're not professional comedians or try to make money making a living making comedy. So I don't really give a shit either way.
Yeah.
But that douchebag, speaking of SNL, who made some joke, was it about Chinatown or something? And then they didn't let him on SNL.
Right, right, right. There was a comic that had a job as a cast member and then he got.
Yeah. Before he did filmed his first show, they kicked him off.
I think it was even from a tweet from years ago, maybe even.
No, it was he appeared on a podcast.
Oh, okay.
And he said
okay.
some joke about China. And he was talking like a Chinese person.
Right, doing this. And yeah.
At first you hear it and you go, oh, there's the woke culture, you know, canceling something. And then you hear the joke.
Yeah.
This guy's not fucking funny. We dodged a bullet by not having him on SNL.
That's why he's on SNL. He's not funny. <Clearly
has to. laughs> But I mean, that's the other thing is like now everybody can have a podcast. I mean, yeah. Look at us. We're yeah. example yeah. number
exactly.
one.
Exactly.
So because there's so many douchebags like us out there making.
At least the three of us are on one though, you know?
Yeah, we all can have separate
bother you
ones.
With two other ones.
I want to take this opportunity to announce my podcast I'll be starting. It's called Where's Comedy with George White. My first guest is Will Ferrell.
It sounds like a blast.
George is using us as a launching pad.
Uh-oh, Where's Comedy?
It's part of the Ear and Loathing Network.
From the Ear and Loathing Network. Spinoff. We have 18 episodes and we all have spinoffs.
So yeah, I don't know. You just got to find what's sort of intelligent now because like there's not things are like, I watched the show, The Boys. I don't know if you watch that. It's I think it's pretty cool. Mm-hmm. And it's so dark and violent and gory
yeah.
that they extract humor out of that sometimes,
you know, yeah.
which I find funny.
Yes.
And it's done in a smart way, I think. Mm. But other people might disagree with that. That's fine. But to me, if you're erring on the side of intelligent, even if it's in a gory scene or something, that is a lot more the direction you should be going in with comedy as opposed to, yeah. I want to be the next Adam Sandler, which is kind of dumb sophomoric humor, which, you know, you can't do that anymore, first of all, because like booby jokes and stuff are just, they don't fly anymore.
Right.
Thank Christ. Like, who needs any more of those? Like, what, on our text exchange, on our text group tasks, we plenty of that, but not on the air, folks.
Yeah, come on.
But anyway, so that's where I would look for my comedy is on the smarter side as opposed to the boy. I really miss Yahoo Serious.
Yeah. Serious. Wow, that is cool. Oh my, he was Australian?
Right? I don't even know.
Maybe he's going to be the new Paul Crocodile Dundee, right?
There was just like ads upon ads for that guy for like 6 months.
Young Einstein? Or what was the name of the movie where he was...
Something like that.
Yeah, he had a... Yahoo Serious had a movie. And
yeah.
It was,
yeah. Yeah, I think you're right.
He's no Yakov Smirnoff.
Yeah. Well, anyway, who else has thoughts about comedy and where we're going? No takers. No, it's like a Zoom meeting. Anyone have questions?
Anyone have questions? I have one thing. One thing that occurred to me that I kind of off is same topic, but that I'm sure all the other people in Saturday Night Live, all the Kate McKinnons and the rest of that cast, who you know for whatever you think about them, they're not Pete Davidson. Like they studied and would busted their balls at UCB or Second City or whatever. Yeah. And this guy comes along with his long cock, going, ooh, and he gets everything.
Yeah. They just supposed to be rolling their eyes.
Just like, guys, fuck, really?
Pete Davidson's going to do one of his SNL segments where he talks about being Pete Davidson.
Right, exactly. I mean, I have four characters I can do. Like, they're all great.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't get
he's
him at all.
He's the star. Okay. Well, I'll get a stupid tattoo in my chest.
Right. Do we think he's ever going to have a hit movie or anything or a show?
There's already been two.
He's had hit movies?
Well, that's the thing. I don't know what a hit means. I mean, the last thing...
He's had movies. Like, well,
King of Staten Island was in Judd Apatow produced that.
Was it good, though? Did people care about it?
I didn't like it, but it was on it. I'm sure it got a lot of views and you know stuff on Netflix or wherever it was, yeah. And that was what? Aaron, maybe... Did you watch that movie maybe a year or two ago?
Nah.
You didn't watch it? Nah. Didn't catch that one. Didn't catch that one. I was busy that night.
That night it aired.
Night it aired, I missed it. Was it on NBC at 10? I missed it that night.
I just think in 10 years, we'll be having a conversation, and we're going to be like, yeah, that guy with the big dick on SNL, what the fuck was his name?
He was a big dick? Well, and he had a big dick.
He was like both. Pat something. Fuck, you know who I'm talking about. Like, we're not going to remember that guy. I don't care if he has movies now. He sucks, and he's boring, and he's not funny, and
I'm interested in seeing a Pat Summerall movie.
I would like to see a Pat Summerall. He died recently? Who would pay
not
Pat?
Not a biopic. I want him in it. I want him starring in it.
Oh, yeah, he boy.
Pete Davidson as Pat Summerall?
Ooh.
No, Pat Summerall as Pat Summerall and Pat Summerall story.
Now we have a pitch.
Well, they've got that de-aging You know, okay. He can play his young self at 25, just getting into the industry.
Okay, listen to me. Here's where, okay.
He could also play his dead self.
Pete Davidson as Pat Summerall. Stay with me.
Okay.
I don't have anything else.
I'm out.
I'm in.
You took me from in to out.
George, did we solve this or not?
I don't think there is an answer. There isn't an answer, but we can move on.
But we can still. Now, do I have to cue you up for this, George, or can we?
I'll do my line again. We may never find out. Maybe there isn't an answer.
I have my answer.
That's the one.
That was good.
Yeah, you actually were ready that time. You've been studying. Mm-hmm. Because that's the one that always just collapses.
Come to rehearsal, would you? Come on, Learn, just learn the parts.
Come on, man. I know you're banging Kim Kardashian. Come on, Pete. Show up to rehearsal once
Learn
in
the
a while.
Lines, okay?
So, all right. You know what's not funny is you having to go into the torture chamber.
It's not funny.
Yeah!
I tried to think of a topic that we could talk about for a long time, but it didn't work.
So all I can think is, like, get your ass down there right now.
Torture chamber.
Okay, I'm not going to bullshit you, okay? I don't really give a good fuck what you know or don't know. But I'm going to torture you anyway.
Suffering. Anguish. Pain. Torture.
Anguish.
Yes, it's that time of the week when George has to go down to the torture chamber and eat his broccoli.
He did. And get fed balls.
So Aaron went first last week with Wasp, which means I think I have to go first this week.
Yes.
I know it means that.
I don't need to be told. I know it.
I'm going to send it to committee and we're going to table it and see what happens. All right. You're right, Aaron.
All right.
Committee.
I'm just not even going to look at whatever I'm not going to anticipate anything. I'm just going to sit here and fucking take it.
All right. Here we go. Torture time. George style.
Fuck you.
Fuck yeah, this song fucking rules, dog.
It's the nature of the business. It's the Smuggler's Blues.
Dude, fucking Zero Smuggler. Irony Cafe. Dude, I'm in.
Oh, I'm in.
Sonny. I have thoughts.
Oh, Sonny Crockett.
15 old hash.
All right, here we go. Got some Glenn Frey, Smuggler's Blues, 1984. From the album The All Nighter. And there's a few facts about this song that you may have wrong, because a lot of people do, including me, until I read about it. But let's get into it a little bit.
Sure.
Into some good old fashioned rock and roll. By the way, I have the lyrics over here if you want to see them.
No, I got them.
I need your fucking lyrics.
I was anywhere in 1984.
51 years
I know
old.
All
baby.
These lyrics.
All right.
The politics of contraband.
They hide it up in Telluride.
What's that?
They hide it up in Telluride. I mean, it's here to stay.
Okay. Kill everything exploded in the blood
and the spill. Oh, by the way, I want to tell you real quick about that line.
Yeah.
I was looking up, you know, analyses of this song.
Sure.
And one article I found was his Glenn Frey's obituary in The Atlantic.
Oh.
The magazine.
Yeah.
And they wrote an article about old Glenn. Wasn't focused on Smuggler's Blues, but, you know, it was just kind of about his career.
It's a missed opportunity.
But this is what the guy said. This is a quote from the article, not very long. Frey and Henley both talked a lot about how much they sweated on the words to their songs. And you can see that work in the economy and directness of Smuggler's Blues. And then he quotes the line we just heard. I knew the gun was loaded, but I didn't think he'd kill. Everything exploded and the blood began to spill.
Wow.
Now,
what a rhyme.
This is how I envisioned this article coming down. Glenn Frey dies, and I can just see the writer's face when he's the new kid on the staff, and the editor's doling out assignments to the to the writing staff.
Sure.
And he looks at him and he goes, hey, Junior, you got the Fryo bit.
You're on Fry.
And this guy's like, fuck, how am I supposed to find something good to say about Glenn fucking Frey? And the best he could come up with was quoting a line from Smuggler's Blues.
The economy of his lyrics.
Yeah. Well, he goes, yeah. Well, he rhymed.
I would have loved that detail. Fuck. They would have said, you got to fucking tame this down, bro. It's too much.
He found a way to rhyme kill and spill. I guess that's what I'm going with. So anyway, that line is just, it's fucking horrible. And, it was so weird that someone, you know, keyed in on it as a good, quote unquote, good line that Glenn Frey wrote.
Yes.
I think not. Mm. Carrying on. With a suitcase in your hand, here's a little money now. Do it just the way we planned. You'll be cool for 20 hours and I'll pay you 20 grand. By the way, we're going to get into this later. I'll actually sing it for you. But that little vocal affectation was so Life in the Fast Lane.
Oh yeah, oh yeah. Oh,
cool. And if you sing the melody of Life in the Fast Lane over this song, it's the exact same song.
From the man who brought you.
Yeah, and I'll
Something works, you know.
I'll regale you guys with my singing later.
I can't wait. I'm anticipating. Yeah. This is great.
So here we go into, I guess, what you would call a chorus.
Smuggler's Blues. Smuggler's Blues.
And so I'm going to tell you something that a concept I came up with. I'm considering this episode 2 in the epic song cycle known as Glenn Frey's Jagoff Street Trilogy. And
is the cooch part of this?
Very well could be. Episode 1, The Heat Is On, lyrics. The Heat Is On the Street. Episode 2, Smuggler's Blues, we heard it earlier. There's trouble on the street tonight. Mm-hmm. Episode 3, You Belong to the City. You're out of your room and down on the street. You can feel the crowds in the midnight heat.
Well, that's like Will and Spill.
Like, I now realize how confused, the same way I was confused by Run Joe Run and Run Joey Run.
Yeah.
I was like, every time you turn around with Glenn Frey, he has a song about being on the street.
It's from the streets.
Yeah.
It's all he knows.
It's all he knows.
Does no one pointed out, hey, Glenn, write about, like, I don't know, the beach or something. Does it always have to be like heat coming up from the street? And then Don Henley chimes in, as you recall from our other episode, with Can't You Feel the Heat Coming Off the Street? And all she wants to do is dance. These guys are such douchebags.
They had a big hit with Life in the Fast Lane, on a street.
There is a lane that.
Well, that's a highway.
Yeah.
They both have BSs, guys. Bachelor of the Street. That's where they went. It's right next to School of Hard Knocks, bro. Right.
They went to graduate school.
BS.
So, carry on. The sailors and the pilots, the soldiers and the law, the payoffs and the rip-offs and the things nobody saw. No matter if it's heroin, cocaine or hash, you've got to carry weapons because you always carry cash. Nasty reputation as a cruel dude. Said he was crude. It's the lure of easy money. It's got a very strong appeal. They had one thing in common. They were good in bed. Called the doctor. Lights are turning red. Life in the fast lane. Right?
You're very close, yes. Very close.
They told him, give us a new lane. Give us another lane.
We're not going to add a lane to hit highway.
You know, I love the idea of them on stage just talking about it. Well, I figure we'll do New Kid in Town, follow that up with Lane.
Just written on the sheet. Lane, we'll fast, hotel.
We'll do Lane with the special lyrics about the Chrysler building.
Glenn, do you have any cul-de-sac material?
Do I? How much time you got?
What rhymes with boulevard?
2, 3, ho! It's called I Want to Get Back to the Cul-de-Sac.
Aaron, you've just been a lot watching a lot of Miami Vice. This song is so synonymous with Miami Vice, just because the content. Yeah,
that's all it is.
Wait, was it in?
Thank you for bringing it up.
Yeah,
the episode's called Smuggler's Blues.
Oh, it is.
Starring Glenn Frey.
Oh, and he's in it. Okay,
I'll tell you the history, because a lot of people, maybe not you guys, but a lot of very smart people thought that Glenn Frey either wrote this song for the episode or that he was inspired by the episode or something like that. Mm. No, he wrote the song and released it, and Michael Mann, who is the producer of Miami Vice.
So it sounds like an episode.
Was intrigued by this concept of a smuggler, you know, having the blues.
Right.
And he sent one of his writers away to write an episode call it Smuggler's Blues. Mm. And it has, I guess it features Crockett and Tubbs going to Cartagena.
Yes, of course.
And Glenn Frey plays the pilot who flies them there.
That's right.
So
damn right he does.
So believe it or not, this song inspired the episode.
At first, they don't like each other, but then they forge a begrudging respect.
Yeah, that's right.
After participating in a shootout where Glenn, you think he's going to turn tail, he doesn't.
Well, that's every Miami Vice episode ever.
Yeah.
And so the reason why I think people got confused is now flip the script. He ended up in a episode as, and I think the song "You Belong to the City" was featured very heavily in that.
Yeah, episode. He's not in that episode, video, though. Maybe, right, or something.
It's the first episode of season two where they go to New York to solve a crime, and Don goes out for a walk because he's had it with the fucking Gotham bureaucracy, and so he goes out to fucking rip a few filters off a Camel, and they play that song as he's walking in the blue light of the city.
Yeah,
what else do you want to know?
Because he's a man of the streets, as we've established.
He's on the streets.
Yeah,
that's right.
In some espadrilles and
fucking
a pink
shirt. Right.
And he can feel the heat coming off the street.
Yeah, nothing says the street quite so much as espadrilles.
Yeah.
This fruitcake's not wearing socks over here.
Yeah. Hey, wait. Give him a reason to kick ass and call somebody a bozo.
Bozo, you don't got the stones.
You guys, confession. I swear I've never seen a single episode of Miami Vice.
Really?
Never.
You are not an American.
I just want, these guys look like a bunch of douchebags. I don't know what I was doing.
Point.
I can go masturbate for like an hour instead.
Really? An hour? Huh.
Well, yeah. I'm 16.
Oh,
come on.
16. Okay, right. So four times. Okay.
All right.
Let's smuggle some more.
Bone Smuggler's Blues, am I right? Oh, by the way,
there's every great musician on this song.
You know what? It's about 17 guitar players, none of whom you would know,
really?
Including Glenn. And then there's a studio drummer who played with a lot of people. You wouldn't know him either, but he does have an actual resume. But no, it's just a bunch of faceless dummies.
I thought you were going to say, for like, so-and-so's playing slide guitar.
Right, Jeff Porcaro.
It's John Bon Jovi on slide guitar.
So this part coming up right here, you know, I pointed out the Eagle, the Life in the Fast Lane earlier.
Yes.
This little part here, I went, oh, he's doing Mick Jagger from Gimme Shelter right here. Went, listen to this vocal part he's doing in the background. The intro of Gimme Shelter. You know, he's doing that high falsetto. Yeah.
I think you're reaching.
I never noticed that at all.
I think you're reaching because it's a falsetto.
Listen,
in a descending melody, it's ripping off that.
Listen, the reverb on it and everything. I don't know. Come on. It's very reasonable to say that.
You're looking for problems now.
Dude, look.
Poor Glenn. He's in the grave.
Glenn's a piece of shit. That's it. That's all you're saying. Okay.
You're 6 feet under. You had tummy trouble.
You had tummy trouble that day.
No, that's what killed him. He had some kind of awful fucking stomach lining problem. Sounds awful.
It's from transporting all that coke in his stomach.
Yeah, you have to do that. You have to do
that. They hide it up in Glenn's belly.
Yeah. He calls his ass Telluride.
I'll tell you what.
That's what he means, hide it up in Telluride. Hey, we gotta get the Telluride out of this guy.
Aaron, you're a dick. When you hear this later, you can't hear it over the fucking Zoom call.
Totally. I know what the
I'm not
song
saying
sounds
it's
like.
An exact ripoff. I'm saying it's very reminiscent, and I'm sure he
I've never
it.
Heard that before, so it's enlightening to me.
Thank you.
Okay.
Aaron's trying to sabotage my torture. It's just not going to happen. It's fucking Smuggler's Blues.
Blues!
By the way, thanks for the long version. I'm pretty sure this single doesn't have that in it.
I think it does because
the video tells a full on story, so they needed every moment of as possible.
The great thing where the cop's the assassin.
Fuck yeah, he looks like Castillo, but it's not. It's a fake Castillo. It's Castino.
So many small plot lines. Damon,
since you're not familiar with the Castillo, it would be Eddie James.
Eddie James almost.
This guy's Andrew James almost. He's almost.
Crockett and Tubbs' boss. So. Okay.
That's right. You're putting the whole unit at risk.
I did watch the video.
That's for you, Chris Mason. Sorry. Used to do a great Castillo impression. What's this, Crockett? A requisition order for a Lamborghini? You're putting the whole unit at risk.
Do you know the story about Eddie and not looking at Don? Do you know that story,
no.
Aaron?
All
right,
no,
so
I
read a whole thing about, because you know how he always was looking down,
right?
When Don came in the office,
he's had just about enough.
No,
always.
And Eddie in the first episode, he doesn't like Don as a person or as acting or what he's doing in the scene, and so he's he tells Michael Mann, like, I'm just not gonna fucking look at him. I'm not gonna look at him. I can't fucking look at this guy, so I'm not looking.
Well, he doesn't really look at them for like a year.
For the whole first season, he didn't look at him, and then it worked. They're like, "Well, we like it, so keep doing it."
Wait, we made up. I want to look at him now. No,
no, we like that. You're always looking down, like, "Oh, this fucking guy again."
Yeah, he hates them both for the first, because he's only in the first or the second half of the first season, because it's another guy first, mm-hmm. And then so for the whole back half. He doesn't give them the time of day, but then they're all bro out in the second season.
Right. Huh. More blues, please.
Yeah. More smuggling, please.
More smuggling.
Perhaps you'd understand it better standing in my shoes. I think this is a little extra solo. Though now, I think now you're right, George, where they're adding this is a sweet extra solo.
Fucking ever. What?
Well, nice. Sound of the streets.
Maybe, but it's only like according to what I'm looking at, a 4-minute song.
It seems like four days. Wow, wow, wow. More of this fucking weird, this fucking slide guitar, whatever it is.
And also, you know, the obvious thing that we pointed out for the Don Henley episode, which we should explore a little more now, because the fucking hypocrisy of these guys, like, who's doing more coke than Glenn Frey and, like, Don Henley and Don Johnson?
I was going to
ask. In the studio at this moment.
Yeah.
I was going to ask that. Do you know when? I was going to ask, he knows a lot about the game here with this. Who decides to write about this?
Okay.
When did he get clean?
I can tell you.
When did he get clean?
No, there's no evidence that he did.
Oh.
But
I thought there was a year he did. No, Aaron?
When he got healthy when I was in high school. Like, I remember because he did that.
Oh, he did those gym memberships.
Right. Yeah, that's what I thought. Yeah. Right.
Because he said his one picture said hard rock. And then the next picture was rock hard.
Right.
Like,
I remember
using the solo flex.
Yeah.
Glenn Frey said in the 1986 book Behind the Hits, they asked a bunch of people about their hit songs. And he said, you don't spend 15 years in rock and roll without coming in contact with entrepreneurs. Wink, wink, nudge, nudge.
Ha ha, I get it.
I've wanted to write a song about drug smuggling for a long time, but I'm glad I waited for this one. It says everything I wanted to say on the subject. I'm proud of the lyrics. It's good journalism.
Good journalism. Take it easy, Glenn.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
The guy who wrote the obituary about this song was better journalism than I thought.
I couldn't hate this worse, but that quote just...
He's such a pretentious prick.
It's good. By the way, you a songwriter and a journalist. I'm a journalist now.
I'm a journalist first.
Documentarian.
Yeah.
Humanitarian.
Yeah.
Clean and sober.
Yeah. I like to report on the human condition. Henley's the same way. All of their Eagles songs, not all of them, but a lot of them were about, you know, finger pointing people and, you know, people who use drugs and, you know, living life in the fast lane. And they were doing it more than anybody. You know, so fucking preachy. I fucking
yeah, write what you know.
Every you think I would soften up on these guys or mellow out more, but I hate them more now today than I did ever. They're just the biggest pricks. In fact, while I'm on the subject, I was going to save this for later, but I found a website. It's a Glenn Frey fan website. Believe it or not, I'm sure the traffic is, you know, is incredible.
Well,
on
you're
that.
The mud in their eye, aren't you?
I think I'm the only visitor. Welcome. Congratulations. Like there's a bell ringing at the office. You guys, we actually had someone visit. But so he was talking about in this period, I'm going to say like more later 80s, a few years after this song, about how not long after this, when You Belong to the City was in the Miami Vice episode. Mm-hmm. And then Pepsi did a campaign with it. As well.
Yeah, that's what I remember. That's what I remember. Okay.
And so I guess he got some shit for it, for you know, selling a song, selling out, you know, to corporate Pepsi. So I've got like pages of quotes, but I bolded the ones that I really want to say that about his response in various interviews at the time when he was getting shit. And do you guys want to know why Glenn Frey is such an unlikable, defensive asshole? Here we go. On selling music to corporations for use in commercials. Sure, I did an ad for Pepsi. They're a corporation, but no one talks about the 20 million, 40 million that these corporations injected into inner city projects. Fucking asshole. All right. And then I've got 21 people directly dependent on my turning over at least a million a year. So he's trying to make you feel guilty.
Because I got a big nut, guys. I got a big nut.
Right. Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry, you hired people. Here's another one. Plus two elderly parents to support, and you know Reaganomics is doing nothing to help them.
He's rich. Reaganomics did everything to help him.
I know. Such a defensive prick. A couple more. A couple short ones. People drink soda pop. I don't consider Pepsi to be the enemy.
What are you gonna do?
And finally, okay, sorry, a couple more here. This is from 1988, and I guess people like Steve Van Zandt and Neil Young were giving him a hard time.
Yeah.
About this, about the Pepsi thing. And so he goes, hey man, having a social conscience doesn't make you a better songwriter. If little Steven and Neil Young don't like me doing Pepsi commercials, I trade insults at 40 paces. When has integrity even been synonymous with rock and roll?
Yeah, he it was, both of those guys were so exposed in the beautiful documentary, the Eagles documentary, was fucking amazing.
Yeah.
But just like the pricks that they are, dude. Yeah. Just like extraordinary fucking pricks.
He take, you know, that verse in the Skynyrd song about Neil Young?
Yeah.
That's like a love letter compared to this. This is him still talking about Neil Young. My last quote, I promise, guys. I don't know what's worse, releasing 17 albums that sound like demos and taking the public's money for that, or me taking $1 million from Pepsi. Right, Neil? Who's ripping off who, guy? You haven't made a decent record since Harvest, Neil.
In this case, we agree. Quentin and I are right on the same track.
But you guys, how fucking angry and defensive is this guy?
Yeah.
He just sounds like a fucking man baby.
Yeah, sounds like somebody else we've spoken about before on this fucking podcast.
Whoever could that be?
Buns Jovi.
Buns. Exactly. Yeah.
Buns Jojo.
Good old Buns.
Nice buns.
I like your buns.
Yeah, no, he's a fucking pill and a half, huh?
Yeah.
You just feel like those guys should just be full of glee. No one should be laughing more than those guys. Like constantly laughing right. All the time, laughing.
All the
no
way
one could bum them out or bank. Say anything shitty. They just go, yeah, I know, I'm in the Eagles. I know.
And
just
crazy.
Walk away
Who
from
knew?
Everything.
I could have been a backup singer the rest of my career, but I'm in the Eagles.
Right.
Yeah, but you did this and you fucked up this and you sold to this. I know. I fucking did it, baby.
So back on Smuggler's Blues, we're coming in the verse now. If you remember the video. This is the verse where he's in the interrogation room.
Yeah.
And he's testifying, if that's the right word, the lyrics. And he's acting out the lyrics.
They did that quite a bit.
With a smoke-filled room and everything.
They did that quite a bit in the 80s. That was a very conventional way to do a video.
Yeah, it's pretty heinous. But here we go. George is acting it out right now.
Yeah. You know, a lot of fucking dealers
are
like,
there's a microphone and he's testifying. Right. They hide it up and tell you, right?
Why are you saying all of our shit, dude? Glenn.
Right. You guys stupid? You guys stupid. This is what they're doing.
Fuck up my fucking smuggling world because you don't do fucking hot frosty rails off strippers' buttholes anymore? Fuck you, Glenn.
But the rest of us would still have, you know, the rest of the 80s to get through.
Should have got a young man in South Pasadena. He's looking for a sack. Come on.
What was that? What was your thing in 1984? Whatever you when you with your are you going to graduate? You were quote coming online hard with chicks and drugs.
Yeah, I don't think I said drugs, but
I think you did.
No, I said chicks and rock.
And rock. Okay.
Did I mean drugs? You want to let me finish?
I guess yes, I heard it too. Wrong.
I think you said chicks and baking. That's when you started your baking career, right?
Yeah, I got a real fucking purple thumb from the grapes.
At one point, we had to pull him aside. It was like an intervention. Like he was getting into like tarts and stuff, and it was just too much.
I swear to Christ, you make another fucking flan, I'm gonna fucking.
This isn't you, man.
This isn't you, Aaron. This isn't Aaron.
You're
I
more than Mexican custard, fucker. I said it.
This isn't the Aaron I fell in love with.
If it takes not being your friend anymore, because I tell you the truth, that that's the way it is.
So the other thing that maybe we could throw this on the table real quick, because we're almost done with this song. In fact, we can stop it now if you want. I don't care. But
cocaine or hash.
Okay with me.
But what was his songwriting position? Because it's almost a celebration of this lifestyle of being a smuggler, and people are dying and drugs are being passed around and, you know, laws are being broken and blah, blah, blah. This is right in the middle of Just Say No.
Oh, yeah.
And so
I think that the only way, because he gets shot at the end of the video, but he doesn't say that in the song.
No, and the song is just kind of like open-ended, right. Like, hey, well, I guess I'm still a smuggler.
He's just being a journalist in the song.
I gotta stay undercover, guys.
Yeah. It's Edward R. Douchebag.
All right, let's hear the rest. We should hear the rest. Let's hear it. We should hear the rest. For the fans, in case people
you
are
should
liking
hear the rest.
I should. Wrapping up the governments in Colombia and Peru. You ask any DEA man, he'll say there's nothing we can do. From the office of the president, right down to me and you.
More you, Glenn, than me. Me. I'm 14. Me and you. It's a losing proposition, but one you can't refuse. I guess I don't understand. Oh, sorry, the good line coming up here. But I really just don't understand, like, who was relating to songs like this, his Heat trilogy? Like, who was thinking, like, I'm the guy out on the street, and, you know, there's, like, heat on this, like, who relates to these songs? Because real guys who are in, like, crime and stuff aren't listening to fucking Glenn Frey.
Well,
and so we've got kids who watch MTV couldn't relate to a guy living in the city life and everything. You
sure.
did?
Well, sure you could, yeah. I mean, that's why
you in watched. Burbank, you were having these feelings?
Well, no, yes, but the same thing as saying, why does anyone watch Miami Vice? I'm not a cop in Miami chasing drug dealers, but it's exciting and it's sexy, and that's why you like a song like this. Sure.
They had fucking hooks for days. I think that people thought that it was interesting lyrically because it told a story. I mean, back to our story songs. I mean, this song is better than a lot of those fucking 70s story songs, and it's
is it?
And it's, I think it is. And as far as its delivery, I mean, it's iconic. It, most people bag on it. I mean, I think it's goofy, but I also have a soft spot in my heart for Glenn in general, even though he's just a yutz. But like, you know, I don't know. I mean, yes, it is goofy for real, for sure.
And Aaron, do I have to redo those quotes again?
I have four more pages of quotes.
It is so beautiful that he's such a fucking humorless prick, you know, when like, that's the thing that makes me love it so much, where like he and Don just should be fucking playing Yahtzee with fucking doubloons, you know, and they just have no time to call Mr. Felder. Oh my God. Shut
right,
up.
Right.
Yeah.
Mr. Felder, as it says in the lawsuit.
Yeah.
Too bad Glenn's no longer around to hear us talking about him.
Too bad. Let's hear more of
it. You know what? We're going to get a new pickup in fucking somewhere in Hollywood from Mr. D. Felder. Now a fan.
All right. So we're about to hit the best line of the song, right?
There's so many good ones.
Yeah. It's the politics of contraband.
Politics and contraband is this. He had one of your hour-long JO sessions when he's fucking the politics of contraband. Are you shitting me? That's the name of the record. Yeah. Oh, all nighter. We already did the art. Fuck. Oh well.
Damon was having an all nighter in his room. Oh. So, all right. Really, do we have to listen to any more of this?
We don't have to.
Because I think
we owe it to the fans.
The Glenn Frey fans.
Yeah.
They come to our show for...
or people that want to argue it. You know,
quality analysis. All right. I think he's done. Yeah, it's we got 30 seconds of that.
Okay, okay.
We're done.
Cut it off. All right.
So there you go. Some Glenn Frey, some Smuggler's Blues.
Smuggler's Blues.
Such a douche. In fact, I was talking to Zader about this last night, because I was... It was a toss-up for me. If you guys listen to... Smuggler's Blues is sort of more tangible to grab onto if you're just listening to it. Mm-hmm. But to me, We Belong to the... Or what is it called? We Belong to
You, belong.
You belong to the City. Yeah. Is a way worse song than this.
I would agree.
And I was on the fence, but then Zader just started like quoting lines from this song, and I'm it's got these iconic shitty lines in it. Like
I think it's way better writing than I mean, honestly, it's more creative than You Belong in the City, Concrete Under Your Feet, living in a river of darkness beneath the. Oh God, I fucked it up. Oh well, you know what I mean.
Yeah.
Beneath the neon light.
This Smuggler's Blues was written by Frey and a guy named Jack Tempshin, who has a long history with the Eagles. He wrote Peaceful, Easy Feeling and co-wrote Already Gone. So that motherfucker, having to do no work as far as like touring or recording or anything, gets two songs put on the biggest selling album of all time. And just, in fact, I know my mom comes up a lot on this podcast, but he's in San Diego somewhere.
I was going to say, he's been in a nice house on the beach somewhere.
She's met him a couple times. I think they were, you know, went to the same charity events or something. Yeah. And she says he's a perfectly nice guy and everything, but who wouldn't be? You wrote a couple songs and then the Eagles put him on their greatest hits. And then you just fucking, he probably doesn't just own like a house on the beach. He probably owns an entire beach.
Probably.
Like he owns all the coastal land on Del Mar. Del Mar.
Fucking Jackson Browne has a significant career, but truly the major money was from
the Eagles.
From the fucking Eagles co-writes.
Yeah.
He didn't have to do a minute of studio time, or he was at the photo shoot for the second record.
Yeah.
That's all he had to do.
The photo shoot. Like he one came of the by. Gunfighters.
Yeah. Well, he was, because they had to do a bunch of the gunfight. Well, anyways.
Yeah. The Desperado album.
Yeah.
Anyway, so that's Jack Tempshin co-wrote it with Glenn. That's really the only.
All right. Well, one thing, big ups to Jack, because
you
try being around Glenn that long and not having it rub off on you.
Especially
now he's a nice guy in San Diego. You try.
Right. Yeah.
It's not easy. He was,
you know, sober at the time, just like whacked out on fucking coffee, being a dick, talking smack about Felder. Glenn, come on. Mm-hmm. Focus up.
Okay. Come on, Glenn, let's get back to work. What rhymes with politics of contraband?
Nothing. Let's call it lunch after that line.
Politics of contraband.
All right, so there you go. Got some Glenn Frey for you.
Schmolitics of mantra man? I don't know.
How about another slice of marzipan?
Another slice of marzipan?
All right.
Stick this kilo up your can.
There you go. Boom. Dunzo.
Done. Let's get another cup of coffee.
All right, so you ready to be tortured by Aaron?
After that, yeah, I'm ready for anything.
All right, George Torture, here we go.
Okay.
Uh-oh.
Hey, baby. Oh.
Yeah! Yeah! Do it!
Okay, what's the year? It's Paula Abdul, Forever Your Girl.
1988. Yeah, Forever Your Girl, Paula Abdul. This is from her first big record.
Was Straight Up and all those?
Yeah. Let's let it play for a bit more, and then we'll do a little heavy-duty Paula background, because I had forgotten some of the things that were astounding about this. So let's listen to the lovely voice of Paula Abdul.
Yeah.
Yeah, you didn't think it was humanly possible to put every effect ever on a voice, but guess what? They achieved it in the song.
Yeah. I want you to think about a visual, actually, when you're listening to her voice. You remember those, you see in like Little House on the Prairie, somebody got, like, say Ma has a wet rag and she's got to make the rag dry. And she puts it in the machine where she rolls it through the two tight rollers that leave you with a dry rag on the other side.
That's the ringer.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That's what her voice sounds like on the other side. Like, it's like, it's so squoze and painful sounding. That's what it sounds like. So think of that.
Yeah.
Let's listen to literally a couple of lines.
The ringer.
Yeah.
That's right.
The end product.
Yes.
Ma has a rag.
Say Ma has a rag.
So you're saying your voice sounds like a dry rag?
Yes, on a good day. By the way, this song written by Oliver Lieber, who's the son of Jerry, writer of Hound Dog and a million other things.
Lieber and Stoller.
Yeah. So good job, buddy. He also produced it. This album sold 7 million copies in its run and was on the fucking charts for about 2 years, like for real 2 years. And in that time, 6 singles were released. And it started out a month before the record came out in May with Knocked Out. Then it was The Way That You Love Me in August. So from May to fucking August, all summer long, it's Knocked Out. Then Forever Your Straight Up in November of that year is single number 3. Then single number 4, all the way up till February of the next year, Forever Your Girl. Then go to June of the next year, Cold Hearted. Then go to fucking November again, Opposites Attract. So we're almost out of into the third year.
On the same album? Song.
Oh, yeah.
That same record. Yeah.
Wow.
Virgin, and, right, Jen? Or right, Aaron? Virgin Records?
Yeah. Yeah. Right. Virgin Records. Mm-hmm. And so, and to put it in, the reason that I dislike it so much, and beyond just the fact that I was telling, like, I just cannot stand her voice. Her voice is aggressive in its badness. And and I will say the best thing I'll say about it is that she sings like a choreographer. So
you have a face for radio.
Yeah. And it's like, and I had thought, I was listening to it today again, I was like, it's locked somewhere between, so it's out straight out of that Ma's squeezing machine, and then it's sort of like Betty Boop and a prepubescent boy, like those poor, like the things they used to do to poor Michael Jackson when he was a little boy, and they make him sing those Christmas carols that were way too high even then.
Yeah.
It sounds that uncomfortable. It sounds like they're ripping this poor gal apart. And then I'll say, like, on a personal level, though, so that was what I just quoted you timeline-wise was half of my high school career. So half of my high school career was occupied with this. Now, other things were going on at the time, but this was so huge that it was everywhere. And right around 1988, I'd been with the Monas officially for about a year and a half. We were playing shows and we were, you know, working on our dreams and sort of our fantasy scapes about what could happen if you were in the rock game.
Our solid business plan was being formulated at that point.
Exactly. Yes. And so
high charts.
But when this album was so huge, I was immediately started, even with the hubris of the ignorant that I was, the ignorant man that I was, I started to question what the fuck I was doing when this is happening. So here I am, a fucking junior in high school, and I'm like, I don't know what's the fucking point? Like, America has clearly said yes to this, and the world has said yes to this. And like, at the time, Damon and I weren't right. We were helping arrange songs, but it was all Al all the time in our band, that she was writing everything with some exceptions. But I knew Al was never going to be interested in doing this. And I knew Damon and I weren't ever going to be interested in doing this, assuming we ever started coming online as writers. And so I was like, I don't know what the fucking point is. And it like really brought me down. Like, when I reflect on this time, one of the things that get me is that I hated this album because it made me feel vulnerable in a way that I hadn't felt before as a spazzy kid. So I literally felt like I have this dream and it just got taken away from me because this is also true. Years later, it happened again with the Dalton Grant Experience when the first Coldplay record came out. And everybody was saying that what we were doing was passe. The thing now was Coldplay.
Oh.
And yeah, I was like, when you're I just don't see this. And that was the second time. Every other time I would just have balls of steel. Fuck them. Fuck you. We're going to do our thing. It's only a matter of time. But so when I reflect on things that really legitimately for some reason hurt my feelings and hurt my progress was that these two albums. So.
Wow.
Yeah. So like. You had brought this up when we did Limp Bizkit episode, George, where you're like, I figured this would bum you out because you were trying to make it then. Never affected me in the slightest.
Oh, right. Yeah.
They weren't occupying space that I was interested in occupying at all. And my dreams had sort of moved to a place where I wasn't going to be bothered by a pop sensation that sort of had there been a new Paula Abdul at the time.
Yeah.
But Paula fucked me up, man.
Paula fucked you up. She's the one.
Yeah, dude.
Six singles. So how long did this go on? Oh, but she's dating another guy.
It kept happening and kept happening. It was so brutal. And so so I have a real personal vendetta against Paula Abdul. So, but I will say this.
Yep.
You know, I will say this. She was found by this A&R dude who, what's his fucking name? He's fucking guilty is what he is. Found by this dude and knew her because she had been this Laker girl and right. had been found by the Jacksons and worked with Janet and did a bunch of work there and like worked on the Notorious video for Duran Duran. So like she's out there and working. And then she meets this dude who worked for A&M and then started working on her career. What the fuck was his name? I guess it doesn't matter.
The A&R person I remember that for Virgin was her first name was Gemma.
But this is the guy I'm talking about. Yeah. Anyway, so like she's like, I'm a singer too. And he goes, okay. And so I started working on this fucking record that I just told you, 7 million copies, 6 fucking singles, da-da-da-da-da, cost 72 large to make.
Yeah. Wow.
So like that was not nothing back then, but even then I'm sure that was no money.
And by the way, that includes the services of MC Scat Cat. Yeah,
dude. You try getting that guy out of bed for less than $69,000.
You can't do it.
That's the majority of your budget right there. So like it was brutal. Like, and I reflect on it now. It goes, surely it wasn't that big a deal, but I remember being depressed by it. And I mean, Damon knew me then. Like, I wasn't the kind of person to be just like morose or depressed about things. But like this got to me and it lasted, as you say, George, for fucking ever.
Yeah, this record went on forever and ever.
I remember when Paula Abdul's song would come on the radio, Aaron would head straight to the kitchen and start baking.
Now, seriously, though, do you remember all this, Damon?
No, he kept...
Like, Aaron, you just kept this to yourself, yeah, didn't tell your other band members.
Well, yeah, you're not going to say, I mean, at that time, I mean, we were pretty like... freaky deaky, but like we weren't going to have like that kind of a bro to bro. Like it was also probably something that I was coalescing. Like I was trying to put it together.
Yeah.
Why am I feeling a sense of desperation about this nothing bit of business? But I did. It really was tough. And because Damon and I weren't really writing that much, I felt even more out of control because like I couldn't rise to meet it. And I typically had an idea like when people would get mad about like other musicians get mad about popular music of the day, whether it be Backstreet Boys or whatever, I'd be like, no, you're looking at it the wrong way. This is exciting the market is the way I would tell myself. Like, this is exciting the market. I'm not ever going to do anything like that. So what difference does it make? That's great. The little girls have something to buy. They always do. And so, but I couldn't work my head around this.
For something
some
reason, about
fuck
this.
My shit up. Yeah.
Interesting. Yeah, well, so, she's forever our girl. Let's hear it.
She is, dude. Forever.
We're 13 seconds into a 5-minute song.
Okay.
There you go.
Coming up soon, this is just the same thing. I have one more bit of nugget to share with you, but okay. Beyond that, I just needed to tell you my piece.
You needed to go through Ma's rag machine.
I do, dude. Put me through it. Let's play some more of this joy.
She put our ears through Ma's rag machine. All right, here we go. You know
I am. Sax!
Oh, God.
Yeah, so Damon, when you talk about like the 80s that you, when you argue that the 80s were dog shit or certainly not worth the praise that people desire to give it.
The late 80s.
This is what's in your, this is in your mind, I think. It's like songs that are like this with a dumb sax and produced like this that sound like garbage. I think that's what you hear. But like the same year, Music for the Masses was out and it was a great fucking record. So like Kick was out this year. Great stuff going on. So like existed, but God, this sucked. And this was so much bigger than any of those.
My larger point is like, it seemed like in the early 80s, if you looked at the top 10 at any random time, you'd find a lot of good stuff.
Right.
In the late 80s, it was the complete opposite. You'd occasionally get something good. Mm-hmm. They flipped the entire script on music quality from one half the decade to the other. That's mm-hmm. I guess my point.
Yes.
Yeah, no, that's for real.
And also this saxophone is
it's awful, 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 awful. What is that? Is it the rumor that
that guy? Is that a guy in the background?
It's probably MC Scat Cat.
It's two dudes who have some sort of clever name.
Is that Lieber in the background?
No, it's the dudes dancers? Who actually did do the MC Scat Cat stuff vocally, but yeah. they appear over here too.
This is also that time period, and we heard it with Samantha Fox, where they felt like they always had to bring in a rap guy.
Oh yeah,
to color it.
Yeah, yes, and have a dialogue betwixt to that we could take part in.
And some very heavy DX7 bass.
And the guy's getting paid by the fucking note. He's all over the place, man.
Yeah. I was going to ask, just listening to this vocal again, do you guys think that this was even one, you hear about this with heavy metal records a lot, where they had to go line by line?
Oh, dude.
And this one, they maybe went word by word.
Yeah, right.
They just did a word.
Yeah, because it's not easy to, you know, she'd never been in a studio before, let alone being with limited skills. Like, yeah. She was an athlete as a dancer, so she was set up for what that would be like, but it's not in her discipline. It's not in her discipline at all, so it must have been awful.
Yeah.
And it was.
The money probably.
all the 72 grand. Oh, God damn it. It sounds like a car crash running over my very soul.
And I'm glad that they were able to work in I Gave You My Heart and Nothing's Gonna Tear Us Apart.
Yeah.
That's
good
a
one. Good one.
That was not exactly Hound Dog.
It's a dagger into my life, this song.
An existential dagger.
Yeah, yeah. I love pop, man. I love stupid pop. And I find this, like, you're drowning and you're wearing, like, chainmail and you're trying to get it off you, but each verse is like another layer of fucking chainmail. You're just sinking. Oh, no.
Heavy enough for you?
Another sweet layer. Bliss. Sweet bliss.
Davy Jones, here I come.
You forgot the helmet.
So I get down there and she's down there in a scuba outfit. Ethan, if I promise you that way. No!
Everyone around the world, come on! Ba-na-na-na. Wasn't that bad?
Makes you yearn, you yearn for fucking cool in the gang, dude. Yeah. Just yearning for them.
Yeah.
Well, you figure the guy who wrote this, his old man had no problem ripping off Big Mama Thornton and everybody else for Hound Dog. Why should he worry about ripping off Kool and the Gang?
Right. Are you saying that Lieber and Stoller stole Hound Dog?
What?
There's plenty of evidence in a Zeppelin-y kind of way.
Yes.
That they would rehab songs. And like, you know, it's like putting Alan Freed as a fucking co-writer. Alan Freed was a fucking DJ. You know, I think they were all criminals.
Right. Well, that was just to get royalties.
Yeah.
They shouldn't have been credited as a writer. They're fucking criminals. It's fucking highway robbery. They're better than Smugglers.
There's a difference between someone like Elvis would get credited on some of the songs that he obviously wasn't a writer, but they would just say, well, Elvis wants a little piece of it because he's Elvis and he can get it. Fine. You're claiming that two of the most celebrated songwriters ripped off other people's songs.
I'm not claiming. I'm stating it. Yes.
No, I've never heard that. I've never heard that before.
I'm charging them.
I thought they wrote it for Big Mama Thornton, and then Elvis covered it.
You know, I don't know. I think that there was. I don't think that that's true. But you know, it's fucking just as likely true. But like those people in the same Zeppelin-y kind of way, it was just co-op city. You know.
Look, and, I'm not. And by the way, I'm not saying you're wrong. I'm just saying I've never heard that story before, and I always thought that out of all the kind of dickheads in the music industry, Lieber and Stoller were kind of straight shooter.
No, I think that they're also great artists and probably very straight shooters, but I also think that that's an example of a song that they didn't write. That it wasn't their complete property.
George has a thought, but first I just want to say Aaron, like George, didn't do the proper research this week. And therefore,
we need to
go back to the old drawing board.
Okay.
That's right.
I'll call you in an hour.
Can I say something?
Guys? I was too worked up about my therapy session.
But, no, really, coming face to face with Forever Your Girl. Aaron's coming face to face with her.
Yeah, it's tough. I'm sweating down here.
Oh, boy. What I was going to say, guys, is this is a great discussion. We're talking about Paula, though. This isn't about Elvis. It's about Paula.
Yeah.
No, you couldn't get further away from the king than Paula Abdul.
All right. Ugh. Carrying on. This is, I'm pretty sure we're not even getting halfway through the song, but
it's unnecessary.
we're at a minute and a half in and it's a 5 minute song.
Yeah. Cause you're not going to go, you know what? I hate it more now that I was
thanks,
in too
thanks for picking the long version again. It's the 12 inch Aaron Jesus.
Yeah.
Okay. Go some more.
Take those horns.
This guy sounds like a bit of a puss, doesn't he? Like, he's really reassurance.
A puss. Where are you from, 1971?
As a matter of fact,
don't be a puss.
No, like, she's got to sit here and reassure him that she likes him and everything, and, you know, needy little wussy.
Yeah.
She's forever his girl, like, no matter what happens to him.
Right.
Yeah.
Unless well, that's what she's saying.
Unless like, you keep up this bullshit.
Yeah, but the reason that she's got to say all this stuff is because he was crying like a fucking biatch.
Because he's such a puss. Because he's such a puss. Yeah.
These two deserve each other.
Yeah. With that voice and
forever.
His fucking lack of sack. Sack yeah, lack.
She. You're right about her voice. It's like castrati laugh at her.
Yeah.
No, it's fucked up. It's fucked up. It's like a fucked up voice. Yeah. It's there's something wrong with it.
Yeah.
In fact, here's one of my only Paula Abdul anecdotes. I always remember when she and Elton John were doing a Pepsi or Coke commercial. Do you remember that? Was it Coke or Diet Coke or something?
Kind of.
Oh, no. Yeah.
They were singing a song together in this commercial. It was for either Pepsi or Coke. I don't remember. And Elton starts singing, and it's Elton John singing, and he's got that rich, full, you know, beautiful voice. And then she comes in with 75 layers of processing on it, and they're doing a duet in this Pepsi commercial.
Yeah.
I just remember thinking, oh my, because when she's in her own song, surrounded by all this cheap Casio synthesizers, like, you don't notice it as much. You notice it, don't get me wrong, but the second she's on this, like, within seconds of Elton John, you're just like, holy shit, this bitch can't sing.
Yeah, no, like, she's just not. It's just not, she's not built for it. It's like Samantha Fox is like, why are you asking this woman to do it? But like Paula, according to this dude whose name I can't fucking remember, he's way like, you know, we're going to learn how to sing together. She says, I can learn how to sing. I want to be a star. I want to get in the studio, you know? So like she wanted to work hard and, you know, she did and fucking sold a massive record, but God damn it. To what? Yeah. But like, what is the consequence for the world?
This song doesn't seem to have forever your girl. Is that's the melody, right? That's all that's all I'm taking away from the song. Not one other hook other than where she ripped off Kool and the Gang.
That's the biggest one and it's not hers.
This song is it's like there's no substance to it at all. I don't know anything that's going on other than she's singing to this little wimpy guy who's crying. When you were talking to the waiter, it looks like you guys exchanged looks. You know, like he's this
is
guy's
that
real,
your impression of the guy?
Yeah. That was pretty good, wasn't it?
She's like, great. Take it easy, Mark.
Yeah. Mark. Mark, I was just getting another drink.
But Paul, okay? it's just that I love you.
I know him from acting class.
But you're not an actor. I'm not a singer either, Mark.
That's not stopping anyone else.
All right. This douche is playing the role of the needy boyfriend.
Correct.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
It's all making sense now.
But he seems more with it than the guy she's clearly talking about. I don't know. It's all over the place.
With it. He's more with it.
What are we doing with our lives? We're analyzing Paula Abdul.
I know. Don't.
Like every
spending
week,
a beautiful Sunday doing this.
We get to get. I know. God. I could be outside.
Aaron's sharing his hurt with us.
Yeah. I had to tell you I was vulnerable.
He had to tell you. It's, you know.
Two times in my life I was vulnerable. That's it.
I've
don't care what anybody says.
About the previous comment about the Pepsi commercial.
Yes.
In any way, was Glenn Frey paid for this commercial?
You know, he's defensive about
and
it.
You know what? He needed shit. I'm with Elton, Paula. Make your money. Good on you guys. It's just soda pop. Fuck you.
Soda pop's not the villain. It's soda
it's
pop, by
it's
the way.
The devil. Soda
what are you
pop.
Fucking on a stoop fucking in the 50s, New York? You know,
Let me tell you something else. Soda pop. Let me tell you something else, too. You think I've got a nut? I heard Elton John's got a $4 million a month nut. You got to make money, guys. Doesn't grow on trees, okay? Yeah.
I love that. That, like, I've got...
I got a $1 million. I got people dependent on me. I got a $1 million a month.
What a man like me has to do?
Yeah, you know?
To take care of everyone?
That's $12 million a year. Just do the math, okay?
God, I'm an asshole.
I got a couple parents bleed me dry.
Yeah, over here. They're sick.
Those cunts don't show any sign of dying.
I guess they got old.
My old man, that fucking hooker, he's still around. Don't get me started on that.
He told
cracker.
Me I was not going to be anything. Well, now I need my breathing oxygen machine.
He still wants Islanders tickets.
Still wants got Islanders problem tickets.
Has, whose
agent has to make a
that?
Call? What's Islanders tickets?
Oh, gee, Glenn, you know, if I could sit by the glass, the seats weren't so good last time. If you could tell your agent.
I mean, you know people. You're famous. It's a big deal.
Come on, I figure life in the fast lane is good for a couple anyways. Come on. They give you free booze down there, Glenn.
Then he's on the Jumbotron. And here tonight, Mr. Bob Fry.
Bob Fry.
I bought this ranch in Malibu, lousy with adult diapers.
Perfect for the old man. Still bitches.
It's never good enough.
They're three ply. I've said it 50 times, dude. You little pansy.
I love you.
No, but do you really love me?
Just play the song.
Trying to entertain the people, George.
The guy in the Netherlands.
This
he loves
isn't
it when
the
we
way.
The people come to us for our comedy. Oh boy, fuck. Officially halfway through the song. We made a pact early in the song. Would we get halfway through? Are we going to keep going? What do you think?
No. That's fine. I don't give a shit if George hates it any more or any less later on. It's my quality of life I'm concerned about now.
Okay, I have to save myself.
And yeah, I told George exactly why it hurts me so bad. Yeah. And what he takes from that, that's up to him now.
And it is drawing out some toxins from your past. I feel like you sort of did this to yourself, but I'm sympathetic, and I want to know if we should continue or should we cease the pain?
Well, we're turning the screws, and if as 50% of the screw turners, I'd like to retire.
But George didn't have an existential crisis in the 80s from this song.
It's not my business what his problems were.
Do you know how much it's going to cost the outfit to mend his animals? You're not as confused as him, are you?
I'm fucking crying over here.
All right, so vote. Should we continue?
We can stop. It's fine with me.
All right, we all vote to stop because fuck this. Fuck Paula Abdul. Fuck the guy. So fuck the needy guy who she's
yeah,
having to deal
with. Yeah,
fuck
him too.
I mean, as much as I don't like her, I do feel bad for her that this guy's her boyfriend.
Yeah.
Like forever, okay? Do you get it? Fine. Jesus, I'm forever your girl. I think that's what she's saying. Like, shut
yeah,
the fuck up.
I got it. Yeah, I got it.
So, yeah, we have come to the end of the torture session for this week. And yeah. We have The Smuggler's Blues by Glenn Frey and half of Forever Your Girl by Paula Abdul. And now we turn the stage over to George, and it's his moment to shine.
George is the decider.
I'm the decider, and this one's easy. I fucking hate Smuggler's Blues.
Whoa! If we had played the entire Paula Abdul, would your decision have changed?
No, and with all deference to Aaron, when that song came out, I liked it.
What?
Oh, God. So many things are learning about you today, George.
I know. I know. Wasp and this. This is a rough day for me.
You liked it? What's the matter with you?
I did. I didn't buy the whole record, but I had a couple of these singles. I definitely had Straight Up. I think I had this one. Jesus Christ. I like it. As we like pop music, Aaron, I know I'll never convince you, but that pre-chorus, it's like Cool in the Gang, which I didn't realize until you pointed out. And I don't like it now. Like, and back then also, I was horrified by her voice. And everyone was.
Apparently
was
not.
I was. But it's a good, that whole record's a great pop record. That's why it has 7 singles on it.
You know that song was on that record. Right?
I do.
Okay, just checking.
I do. But in the way you'd like Katy Perry or whatever, like it's good pop music.
Who likes that? Don't put our fucking problems on our doorstep.
I'll listen to Teenage Dream all day. I did.
It's another
like that
chick
song.
Who's going to scream at you.
That who's going to scream at me?
These chicks are all screaming. They're all yelling.
No. Her voice is classically the worst ever. And even back then, everyone talked about how bad it was. And even the second record was worse. I'm thinking of
it
that
just
one.
Didn't bother you then.
Promise of a New Day.
I don't understand that logic though.
But I liked because I liked the songs. I liked it.
That are being delivered from her face.
Her face, yes, exactly.
Mm-hmm. We sort of touched on this in the Samantha Fox episode. I remember when we were watching her video and listening to the song, and she can't sing. I mean, she's the equivalent of Paula Abdul on every level, except for the fact that, I don't know about you guys, but I thought Paula Abdul was hot back in the day.
A question of whether or not she was cute?
No, Aaron, I'm not saying I'm justifying. I'm saying the reason why, like, I never had any... I didn't want to listen to Paula Abdul. Her songs suck. But I didn't have an emotional reaction to her because I just like to look at her. So I was just like, that was when you're how old were we at that time? Like 19 or 18 or something?
Yeah, I was 23, but yeah.
Yeah. And so I just want to look at chicks when I'm that age. And so I thought that she didn't repel me the same way that Samantha Fox did, because Samantha Fox wasn't that cute and had shitty music, but Paula Abdul was cute.
I like them both, and now I'm thinking about them together, so. But they're not singing at all in this fantasy at all. I have to ask you, though, did someone tell you that I hated Smuggler's Blues? Because I've joked about that with Bingo forever, and maybe you too, Aaron, right?
We've joked about it on the show.
Okay, have we? Because I hate that fucking song so bad.
There was one. Well, good. I landed on the right one because I was going to do You Belong to the City. And I'm glad. Yeah,
Forever Your Girl would have won.
Okay, I made the right call. But Smuggler's Blues, we've talked about, in fact, a couple times on episodes, we've done the Smuggler's Blues about something else.
Yeah, I
think someone sang like that and we did the Smuggler's Blues.
Oh, God. It's
I didn't know you hated it that much, though. That's good for me. Bad for Aaron.
No, I'll take the loss happily. What I've also lost though is my friend. I don't understand. That's the harder. That's the very much harder thing. Yeah,
I've lost my friend. I can never write a song with you again.
Yeah, I'm brokenhearted. I lost like all the pain that I had before is suddenly resurfacing.
Well, let me shrink you a little bit here.
Awful.
Okay,
awful.
Look at who had trouble with Paula Abdul, right? You. And who went near her again and now has lost a friend. So you went near it again. Whose fault's this, Aaron? Come on.
Trying to address it. Try to be a fucking productive member of society.
You gotta leave teach me. Sometimes
bottle it up, America.
Just don't go near it again. Just don't go near this again. You're going to lose something else.
No, I'm fucking stronger now because I saw that I'm fucking stronger. No, she can't defeat me anymore.
Aaron just texted Amy and said, honey, preheat the oven to 425.
No more baking.
I'm going to get some blueberries.
A couple of torts and I'll be fine. I'm not talking wall-to-wall cakes.
Do we have any sour cream?
Aaron, would that make this the torture chamber?
Tort.
Hey-o.
Hey, thank you.
Hey-o.
Bing bong. Bing bong.
All right. So.
Some sorbet, please.
I seem to have won this round. If anyone's following along, the score is now Damon 7. Aaron 6, George 5.
I'm in the cellar again.
I'd expect that from a guy who liked Paula Abdul.
And Wasp.
Love it!
Oh, boy.
It was a huge day for George.
Huge day for me.
I love this one. I love this one, too!
No, not love. You know. They don't bother
record buying.
Me.
You record buying liked it.
Yeah, I did. Yes, intense. I did. I record buying. I didn't buy the Wasp record.
Anyways. Please play something
else. So we do have some sorbet coming
our
way.
We do. And I hope you like it.
And I think we need the dulcet tones of Majel to glide us in.
Maybe you guys will hate the sorbet. Maybe.
God, I wish it was You Belong to the City. It would be so fucking perfect.
Sorbet. Purify.
Let's purify everything in this room.
Yes.
Shall we? All right, so let's get into the sorbet. Courtesy of Mr. George.
Here we go.
Da, 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 da. What? All right, here we go. I'm looking at and hearing a song I've never heard before.
Yeah.
And I'm looking at a very odd song title. Is there, do you have an explanation about it, or should we listen a little more?
I want to see if Aaron knows what this is.
Oh, do you?
Judas Priest. Is this Diamonds and Rust?
Manalishi with the two prongs.
Oh, Green Manalishi. Right, right. Yeah, Green Manalishi. Yeah. By Peter Green, I think,
yes,
wrote this.
Exactly. So Damon, this is a Fleetwood Mac song that they covered.
Oh, no way.
That's what I love about it.
That does sound like a hippie title, like a psychedelic sort of title.
Did you ever hear their version of Diamond and Rust, the Joan Baez song?
Yeah, they do Diamonds and Rust, and they also do Better Than You, Better Than Me, Spooky Tooth.
Whoa.
Yeah.
This a little odder, I would think, though, to do, like, are you fucking doing Joan Baez?
Yeah. I considered that one, but I like this song better, and I have some reasons why. Go ahead.
And I like how Peter Green got his name into the song.
That's right.
Yeah.
Green
was that
shape.
Deliberate, or was that just a coincidence?
No. LSD.
The main riff in the other part, I'll ask you when we get there.
Yeah.
Okay.
You expect that.
Yeah. The 16th.
Makes it go.
Yeah. That riff, was that in the original?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. They made it their own.
I was going to say it wasn't as heavy.
It's weird. The original is just creepier because his vocal delivery, and it's not as melodic, believe it or not.
Hmm.
They made it more melodic. And what and part of what I love about this is that, to me, it's genius for them to think to do this song. Even though when you hear it, it's less weird than when you hear it, you think, oh, I can see how this would work. It's because you think Fleetwood Mac, Judas Priest,
yeah,
you know, that's too far apart. But they had already done the other two. They'd done Diamonds and Rust and Better Than You, Better Than Me. And I love that this is the beginning of the melodic metal and the height of their career, because British Steel is next with Living After Midnight, Breaking the Law, et cetera, all the... And then after that, Point of Entry, and then A Screaming for Vengeance, which
they're locking it in.
That's they're locking it in right here. Like for them to pick this and do it the way they did it and make it more melodic than Fleetwood Mac had is something of magic for me.
Yeah.
And this is right when they're also figuring out that they're going to, was it on British Steel where they figured out that they were going to do the outfits?
Do all the more than heavy? No, that's where they started on this record. This is Hellbent for Leather, Aaron, but it was Killing Machine in England. In England, it was Killing Machine. And oddly, I chose this version of, which is the studio version. The thing they broke out on is this record comes out 78, and 79 was Unleashed in the East, which is the live in Japan. And that's where this song became a hit, was off of that. I just don't like the live version as much as I like the studio version. But that's where they started to break out, was with the live record the year after this, and then British Steel. So I love that they decided to do this. And did it so well and made it their own.
Yeah. I like, you know me, I'm not a huge, I don't, first of all, I don't associate these guys with, like, you know, poison and stuff like that. I know the difference.
Yeah,
okay.
Different. Yeah, right.
But just hard rock in general, it's a lot of hit or miss for me. But these guys, over the years, I've warmed to them a lot.
Yeah.
They're fucking good, and they've got a handful of great songs. When I hear, I was at the Yard House in Pasadena.
Yeah.
Sitting at the bar having dinner. And they just run music videos there, which is kind of cool.
Yeah.
And with the audio.
Yeah.
And I'm hearing this song in the background. I don't think I could see the TV or see it very well. Like, I would have had to go around the bar to look and see what was on, but I'm hearing this great groove coming at me.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, Jesus, I was thinking it was like either a new band or it's like a Tom Petty song that I couldn't place. Cause you're hearing a lot of bass and you're not hearing the full crispness of the song. Cause it's kind of a echoey bar.
Yeah.
And finally, it's just bugging me so much because I'm loving whatever I'm hearing. Yeah. And I'm like, who the fuck is this? And I go around the corner and it's fucking Judas Priest. And it's the original video.
Yeah. For what song?
I think it was Breaking the Law.
Breaking the Law. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Great.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And not that anyone would ever think Tom Petty is Breaking the Law. But, you know, it's when you can only hear the bass, you're like, what fucking song is this? And I was really surprised that I was loving the song so much. Not that I ever hated it, but I just never cared about it. And then suddenly I'm just going,
oh, great song.
Turns out I'm a Judas Priest fan. Yeah, what the fuck?
It's Sir More of the Manalishi.
Yeah, there you go. Sneaking around, trying to drive me mad.
What?
Did they bring in Kenny Aronoff for that, Phil?
Les Binks, baby.
Now, Judas Priest, I know Iron Maiden, I like, there's a documentary on YouTube about them, and it's like 18 hours long or something. Yeah, yeah. And it's, I'm not a big Iron Maiden fan, but I just love that documentary because they're constantly replacing guys.
Oh, yeah.
Right. And
I've watched that thing like a million times.
Yeah, it's really good.
It's so relaxing, yeah.
Yeah, but did Judas Priest have a lot of the same guys, or did they keep rolling through different
almost
members?
Almost all, different drummers.
Yeah.
But the rest of them all the same, everybody. I think, right, Aaron? They never changed a bass player, right? It was always Ian Hill because he's...
Well, it wasn't always Glenn. It was always Rob and KK until KK left. But Glenn came in a couple albums before this, I think, when they were still on the weird sort of like zoot hats.
Yeah, Aaron, I'm sorry, Damon, they have drummers. A career that goes back into the 60s.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Called Judas Priest?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. From the. They
wasn't even
through.
Originally Rob.
Yeah, it was.
Joined.
They have a. It's they're older than you think. Yeah,
nice.
Yeah, but it was always Rob and KK. Yeah,
they went through so many drummers. That Phil was started by one drummer and finished by another one.
I think three drummers.
Oh, dude, I think it was more than that. Bizarrely, my favorite.
I mean, I'm not
was
concluding
Dave
now,
Holland.
Including and everything before Ripper was in it and all that. You know,
yeah, I think there were
really
three,
Judas Priest.
Yeah, Dave Holland was my favorite.
Dave, right? Dave Holland, because I think this maybe is the last record that Les was on. Because Dave Holland's on British Steel. Yeah.
Three or four. And all the ones that had the best feel to me are him. Mm-hmm. Even though he interestingly looked the worst.
Yeah, because the mustache looked, and all. Right.
So like he's way up two up high. He looks completely with no fluid motion whatsoever. Yeah. But it makes for really like hooky fills. Anyways, that's not what we're talking about now. Anyways, I got a big fan of JP.
Yeah.
Go. Yes, sir. Do it. Do it.
Adam Clayton on bass. Yeah, I'm really curious to hear the Fleetwood Mac version because I know it's the previous version of Fleetwood Mac, which was pre Lindsey Buckingham and everything, right?
Peter, yeah, even before Bob Welch, even before.
Okay, then. Yeah. When they were pretty much a strictly bluesy, blues band.
Yeah, right? And well, so the story is this is towards the end of when Peter Green's in the band, and he takes LSD, and he's having financial problems with the band, and that's the reason he's probably going to leave. And so the Green is all about money. That's what the Green Manalishi is, and he has this acid LSD experience, and then writes this song.
what does Manalishi mean?
I don't know.
Oh, does Peter Green know?
I don't know. It came to him. There's no. This came to him. But the Green money. It's money.
It's like a early Genesis song title, right?
Kind of.
You're like, what the fuck are these guys talking about? And then you ask them, they go, oh, I don't know.
I don't know. I took LSD. I don't know. But what I didn't know was I didn't know until I read this. Peter Green is considered a great guitarist, and
I've heard that.
I have no idea that was. I knew he had done this, and there was versions of Fleetwood Mac prior to this, and prior to the one we know. Mm-hmm. But I didn't know that he was revered. Interesting.
Yep.
Yeah, people who give a shit.
Yeah.
Like who are shredders, love him. I'm assuming mostly for like the vibe and stuff like that. But they love him.
Yeah.
And what I think what's been turning me on lately about Judas Priest when I hear them is their riffery is like almost on an AC/DC level.
It's a lot of the dun 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 dun. They love the grinding.
I mean, I'm not saying they sound like AC/DC, but that kind of where the whole band's just like chunking together through these riffs.
Oh yeah,
it's fucking great.
Yeah, those two guitar players, it's similar to AC/DC the way they operate. The two of them.
Yeah,
KK and Glenn. It's similar. Yes, I get it.
Aaron, were you going to say something?
Oh, they're more of a meat and potatoes rock than. Maiden is that sort of bonanza rock.
We have more proggy.
It's a lot of that.
But
you would never find that with Judas Priest.
Yeah.
And it's always just fucking just thick riffs, but not thick and plotting like Black Sabbath, I do not get.
Yeah.
It's just boring to me. Like they're just fucking rad and big fucking hooks to me.
Yeah, always. I was going to say, he brings his voice and the melodies. I'm assuming he writes the melodies of the songs, or do they all write?
I think so.
Okay, yeah.
But this is a cover, so...
He has like a total... Well, yeah, but in general, like he's bringing that energy of his original stuff to this, which is, as Aaron said, hook. It's like he's got a pop sensibility in this hard rock band.
Well, Rob's gay, right?
You don't say.
Yeah, right. I know. For years, no one knew. And I think that's what he brings to this. He brings a flamboyance with the machismo, with a...
Right. And the whole leather. Like, that's... When we were kids, it was always like, I want to go hang out with the Village People. They look fun. They're all dressed up in costumes and everything. And Freddie Mercury running around with the tights on and everything. Yeah. And then this guy in his leather.
Right.
And you were just like, oh, this rock stars are so cool.
Yeah, right. Yeah, right. I think about
that. And by the way, they're still cool, but it was just a weird, like, you never thought of anything of their sexuality other than that guy probably gets so much tail.
Yeah, right. Exactly. It's all you thought. Right.
Yeah.
And we were right.
We did. Tail is tail, friend. All my trying is up. All you're bringing is
down. Yeah, that's a fat, chunky AC/DC riff to me. Yeah. It sounds great. Yeah. Probably more like Bon Scott era, though.
Yeah.
Yellow.
That ending's such an ass kicker.
Was that ending in the original?
I don't know.
Didn't listen to the whole thing.
Oh. Bad research. Yeah. Terrible research.
We're gonna have a discussion off the air about your research.
Yeah.
So where would you consider that in your pantheon of Judas Priest songs? Is that one of your favorites?
Yeah, it's in the top five. Yeah, it's in the top five. And I kind of rediscovered. I don't listen to Judas Priest in my regular life that much.
Yeah.
But it came on the radio, or, you know, on Sirius somewhere, like whatever, on Ozzy's Boneyard or one of those things. And I'm like, oh yeah, this fucking song's great. And nobody, Bingo and I share a real love of this. And his whole way of guitar playing is just that grinding. No one's better at him than dun 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 dun. Bingo's so good at that.
Right.
But having a pop set sensibility on top of it.
Yeah.
And that's what I loved about this and the precursor to the next records and how this was showing you who they were going to be.
Yeah. What were they like before this?
They were just it's not that they were different.
Would I know a song from the earlier?
It was more ponderous. It was sort of heavier.
It was heavy. This is where more the melody started to come to make them more accessible, like Breaking the Law, where a Damon's going to hear this in a bar and go, oh, wow.
This is cool.
And the Living After Midnight, you know, sounds like Kiss. You know, it's such a very Kiss-like song. But
they were more like Black Sabbath earlier, as far as sort of like
plotting and sword and sorcery, you know, just heavier,
Yeah.
Yeah. So this was, and just the choice to do this seems so weird to pick this song.
Yeah.
But then when you look at the other things of them picking Diamonds and Rust and Better Than You, Better Than Me, which I don't like those two as well as this, although Diamonds and Rust is worth listening to too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This, I bet you way more people know this version than the Fleetwood Mac version.
Oh yeah. 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 For sure. Right? I didn't know there was for years. I heard this song and didn't know it was a Fleetwood Mac song because it sounds like a Judas Priest.
Yeah.
You're right.
Exactly.
Yeah. I didn't know either.
So good sorbet.
Yeah.
And you know what? Like I needed something like heavy and, you know, just like throbbing to get me out of that Paul Abdul garbage we had just been through.
Yeah, and Glenn.
And Glenn. Yeah.
Yeah, just.
It's tough stuff.
Tough stuff, man. Tough stuff.
Yeah, we knew the job when we signed up for it. We're not complaining, but we have to let off steam once in a while.
That's right.
So yeah, that was apparently. Oh, look at you guys. We didn't even break 2 hours. You want to talk some more?
No.
I'm okay. I feel satisfied.
The show isn't as long as our usual shows, but it does feel like we did two today.
It does. It feels like a double.
Yeah, it feels like we doubled down on love.
Doubled down on love.
Good night, everybody.
So, Ear and Loathing, the Gitmo Bros, are saying goodbye this week. And so that will wrap up episode 18.
Wow.
Old enough to buy cigarettes. Can they buy cigarettes? Or is that 21?
I think 16.
You can serve in this man's army
it's
now.
It's at least
too.
18.
Is it?
Okay. Yeah. Vote. Yeah.
And
you can go to Vietnam.
We can fight for your freedoms.
Our episode can now fucking has to join the selective service.
That's right. That's you have to have to sign up.
So start smoking, start voting, and start I don't know.
Start smoking and voting.
And get on over to basic training because we are wrapping up episode 18 and we'll see you next week on episode 19 of Ear and Loathing.
Number one rockers forever.
Bye.
Ear and Loathing.
Ego, was he your ex-boyfriend? No, we were just friends. They fucked.
Mom!
Take it easy. Lower it.
I'm not going to lower it. I have to do this now.
I don't mind you playing it, but lower it.
Tune in next week for more Ear and Loathing. End transmission. Goodbye.